Well, I think India has got some inherent skills. Its corporate profits to GDP is at the lowest ever. The exposure to equity, a country with a saving of $550 billion, has only 5% of wealth in equity. And I feel that, you know, the reform, the government has abandoned socialism and capitalism and come to realism. And I think the kind of reforms the government is proposing, we have had a series of reforms over the last 5 years in terms of GST, RERA, Jan Dhan, and you know, I think all these things are going to come together, the way we disburse subsidies, the labor law changes that we are making, the changes in the farm laws, the opening up of the mining sector, the disinvestment that the government, or privatization the government has announced. So I think we have the least leveraged corporate sector ever in history. And we have had a credit cycle problem, but nowhere in the world does a credit cycle problem occur. You know, once 10 years, it takes at least before the next one, after the last one peaks. So I personally feel we are now having a rejuvenated and resurgent India. And the budget is, you know, conveying much more than that, that the government is going to do what it has to be done in terms of policies to have high economic growth. And at the same time, use the money for proper disbursement of social justice. So I'm extremely bullish.
And so you've always been bullish. When I speak to a lot of people offline...
Bullish. I don't agree with you. I have not always been bullish.
But the perception in the market is, sir, that Mr. Rakesh Jhunjhunwala has lived in India. He's a proud Indian. He's amassed a lot of wealth by investing in the India growth story. And so naturally, that drives his bullish sentiment. What makes your view unbiased, sir?
Well, because I see things as they are rather than what I'd like them to be. And perceptions are not reality, Tanvi. I believe when I look at societies, prolonged periods of growth have come either from colonialism or they have come from skills and democracy. And I think Indians are essentially skilled people. Growth is a process. Everything in India is bottoms up and not tops down. It's a democratic, very varied country. And as time passes, things get better. So, and what I feel is that if you see the prosperities of NRIs and non-resident Indians, whether in Singapore or in America or in the UK, what the NRIs got there is a platform. I think that platform is slowly but surely being built in India. And I think it's all going to come out in a burst. I think next year we're going to grow 10 to 11%. And I think 3 to 4 years, we'll go 6, 8, 10. And I think we're going to have double-digit growth for a prolonged period of time. That's an opinion. And I reserve the right to do.
Sure. But as an investor, sir, I'm sure you must be thinking about...
At the same time, you have growth, corporate profits are a function of growth. India has always had higher ROEs than other countries. And we have huge underexposure to equity. And we have created the mediums by which money could be invested in the markets. We have very good corporate governance. We have a good mutual fund industry. We are absolutely digitalized in the banking industry, in the stock market. So I see no reason why, you know, India should not grow continuously at a very high rate. Consequently, corporate profits are going to go up.
Sure. As an investor, sir, I'm sure you must be thinking about pros and cons all the time. So what's the big risk to your mind? While things are falling in place, coming out of this health crisis, what's the big risk for India that you're thinking about right now?
See, the only real risk for the long-term growth of India, I think, is conflict with Pakistan. Because you have a failed state with nuclear weapons. Apart from that, I think the risk is that the kind of reforms that Mr. Modi has announced and is determined to do, if there is too much protest or for any reason is not able to do it, I think that's a risk. Otherwise, I don't see any other risk.
Okay. What about the resurgence of the virus, sir? Because so far, India's done a good job in terms of containing the virus. I believe the vaccine rollout is also happening. But the resurgence of cases that we're seeing globally, can that derail the story? Are the markets, investors, and businesses prepared for that?
Madam, India has 1,45,000 active cases. nearly, you know, every day either 4,000 cases or either 4,000 cases are reduced. And also the incidence of the virality of the virus has gone down like anything. And the learnability and the knowledge to treat the virus. Yesterday there were 768 cases in Bombay, out of which only 108 needed hospitalization. 85 were asymptomatic. So I don't think it's a fever, man. I'm quite sure there is not going to be a second resurgence or second wave. And I think I got a study conducted in my office. 60% people have antibodies. So there has also been what you call mass immunity. You know, that means, you know, a lot of people are immune today. So I feel this is the last leg of COVID, surely in India and maybe sometime in the Western world.
So in the budget,
in a population of 140 crores, you have 1.4 billion, you have 1,40,000 cases. And you have net additions or deductions of 3,000 to 5,000 cases a day. And 85% of the cases are located in two states, Kerala and Maharashtra. And the government and people are far more vigilant than they were earlier. So I think now it's all over. It's all over except the shouting.
Sure, sir. I want to move on and discuss the divestment plan that the government has laid out in the budget of achieving $30 billion this year. Do you think the divestment framework is moving towards full privatization, something that ties in with Prime Minister Modi's minimum government, maximum governance policy?
Absolutely. That is what this time it is not divestment, it is privatization. And this is the intent the government has announced, and I see no reason why they will not do it. See, everything in India is being doubted. Right, and Mr. Modi, you know, is in absolute political command. Both the BJP and the only man who matters in the BJP are Mr. Modi and Mr. Amit Shah. So I don't see any reason why we should not be able to do it. And now they want to take the disinvestment from the hands of the bureaucrats and give it to a panel. So I see no reason why it should not be done.
And so this bad bank will fix the banking problem?
We don't need a bad bank when the problem is already fixed. Most banks are far more provided than is needed. The corporate sector has the lowest leverage. And remember one thing, that most of the bad loans in the corporate sector have come on questions of integrity and, you know, extreme risk. I think that's all over now. There also I feel it's all over, bar the shouting.
Have to ask you about the topic at hand, something that's part of every conversation to do with the markets these days. Mr. Jhunjhunwala, you could guess it as well. Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies. What is your thinking here? Would you buy Bitcoin?
Ma'am, I won't buy it even for $5. Because, you know, remember one thing, that in the world, it is only the sovereign which has the right to create currency. Tomorrow, people will produce 5 lakh Bitcoins. Which currency will you do? And something which fluctuates 5% a day, 10% a day, can it be a currency? If the dollar goes up by 1% or 2%, world news. Here you have a currency which is fluctuating 10-15% every day. I think it's speculation of the highest order. And I'm not going to buy, and if it's gone up, I don't want to join every party in town. Right? I think the hangover will be much worse. So I don't even put my mind on the Bitcoins. And so no government is ever going to... Yeah?
No, I was just saying, you don't get the FOMO feeling, the fear of missing out when, you know, your peers would be like, but see how much money people have made.
So see, there have been so many times when markets have gone up and I've stayed out. Right? You don't have to join every party in town for me. You should go to the parties which you like. And I will never buy a Bitcoin in my life.
Right. I believe the regulators in India are thinking about banning Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies. You know, just as an outsider's view, do you think that the regulators have a role to play at all? I mean, should they get involved at all or let the market go wherever it has to and focus more on the digital rupee?
Yeah, they should focus on the digital rupee, and the power to issue currencies should be taken away, and it should only be with the state. And that is how it will ultimately be. The biggest sovereign right is to issue currency.
Yeah. No, because there's been much talk about how the regulators must not step into the market. And so I just wanted to get your thoughts in on that.
No, I think not only step in, they should ban all these currencies.
Okay. You believe that they should step in and ban?
Okay, tomorrow I'll start a currency. What does it mean? There'll be 50,000 currencies.
Yeah, fair point, sir. There are bubbles in the markets world over that we are observing right now. Mr. Jhunjhunwala, I do want to get your thoughts there. Mini bubbles, not big bubbles, but mini bubbles, like EVs, right? We're talking about electric vehicles, whether it's Tesla in the US, whether it's NIO or XPeng in China. We haven't heard much on the India EV story. What's your view here as far as India is concerned as an EV investment?
I think the biggest and the best player in the electrical cars in India is going to be Tata Motors. And I must tell you, I'm a large shareholder of Tata Motors. And I think I'm playing the EV story through Tata Motors. And remember one thing, when there was a railroad boom, there is change, there is always excitement. And there is excess. And then you have the survivors and they take it. So valuations will not ultimately indicate the who will be the winners in the race for electric vehicles. But my bet is it is going to be the present large companies, because they have manufacturing capabilities, they have investment capability, they have distribution, they have production experience, they have the ability to design good cars. So I think it's going to be the Mercedes and the Volkswagens and the Tata Motors who are going to be the real winners in the electric motors and the JLRs.
Would they do it solo? Sure, Tesla, because Tesla's coming to India. They're looking to set up shop in India. So my question was, do a lot of these Indian automakers do it solo, or would we see more technology collaborations, value unlocking?
Tata Motors has done solo, and their feeling is that, see, you have to customize the electric cars in India. You know, Indian cars have to be driven in floods. No, I mean, will a Tesla work in a flood? So the question is, you need not have a collaboration necessarily in order to have an electric car. And the question is that we don't know afford the cost factor, what kind of cars. India is a very cost-conscious market. It depends on incentives governments give. So I think there will be some very big local winners also.
You highlight an important point, sir. How EV-ready is India from an infrastructure standpoint? And when do you think we'll get there?
See, we are ready as any developing country, but I think the pace of readiness is going to go up like anything. Because, you know, the infrastructure is the horse or the cart first. So as the sale is, the Nexon car of the Tata Motors has been a super hit. You can go 300 kilometers on a charge, it can be charged in your garage or at your home. So I think we'll get there fast. And as time passes, the pace of change will get higher. Very difficult to put timelines to it.
Sure. No, I understand. And it's good to get your thoughts in on this sector, because it's really what everybody's talking about right now. As I wrap up, sir, my final question. You know, in 2014, you had made a prediction. You had predicted that the Nifty would touch 125,000 by 2030. We are in 2021. The Nifty is at 15,000 right now. Do you still maintain that call? Do you think we can still get there in 9 years?
I won't rule it out, but maybe my prediction was a little too optimistic. I think we could get to 1 lakh or 90,000 by 2030.
Right. And you,
I can only tell you one.
Yeah.
I can only tell you one.
Please give us your final thoughts. Yeah.
India is going to surprise on the upside. Now, I can tell you the direction, the depth will depend on so many factors. But India is on a roll, and consequently, the stock markets will be on a roll. I think people are underestimating the kind of change that has taken place in India and India's inherent strengths.